all so much for coming. Tonight, Elliott Bay Book Company is very excited to welcome poets Judith Roche and Margareta Waterman to read from their newest books. First, we'll hear from Margareta Waterman, a local Seattle poet and founder of Nine Muses Books, a local poetry press. She's published more than 70 books of poetry, and we're so excited to have her here with us tonight. So without further ado, let's welcome Margareta to the stage.
Hello.
Hi.
Are we on? All right. Retrieve. River Appreciation Day, Umpqua River, July 16th, 2011. Trees and winds and sometimes rains, cloud and sun and planets, stars, the fresh face, field of gathered faces, freshened by all day sunshine and all out music, washed by the rivers of summer, joined in glorious unity. Here, in quiet, no near companions, quiet, empty, days, spinning circle of self, content, growing, learning, creating. Bless the tribes, bless all the gathered peoples, freshened faces in the sunshine. Bless the tribes, bless the people from this distance. Let this body stay in quiet, leaving life a little at a time. Dancers of all tribes, washed in wind and sunshine. From here, from my ivory tower, let the generations dance without me. And that was with great humility for William Butler named Gabe Yates, who spoke of that same question. The whole capsule, brain case, waves woven into lace, pulsing as long as the heart beats. Memory and meaning woven in, radiating, reflecting pool. 80 years weaving, colors separate and blended, whirling pool of memory and meaning, pulsing with the stubborn heart. This precise brilliance, where mind and brain are one, stored in this body, never to be seen by another, until the top of the heart no longer receives the impulse to beat. Electricity is gone, and brain no longer holds the departed life with all its glorious complexity. Phaedra. Theseus never loved her. Ariadne touched him till Dionysus took her. Phaedra, the little girl, glamorized by her sister's hero lover. It was an affair of state. Theseus never loved her. Only Hippolyta has his heart. Theseus never loved her. That explains everything. Ariadne, Hippolyta, Phaedra, Medea, what did he have to win such hearts? The long road from Oedipus to Osiris, Jocasta. A man is a man. This is not incest, it is politics. Not incest, he had no interest in me. He wanted to be king. He needed to be a man. Nor lust, nor compassion. He wanted to be king. And I I hired him. I needed some help. If you have a son, he will not resemble you. This breed of men kill a rude stranger on the road, not even knowing he is your father. If you have a son, all men might be your father. Your mother has been able to teach you. If you are a father, any man might be your son. Not the woman, but the fame and power. Only this arouses him. And all unknowing. After you know, too late for blindness. Even in your remorse, you make yourself a burden. Jocasta, reduced to simple, do I exist? Helen is real and her bloody sister. I have not the capacity for blood. Bloodless Jocasta without personality, not even myth. Persephone, though utterly mythic, has qualities and a soul. Poor Jocasta, no qualities at all. No presence, only the symbol. Helen herself, Clytemnestra herself, Persephone, Medea, even Phaedra, a story, a clear ray of identity. Jocasta has no qualities, only a symbol. That scripture may be fulfilled. The fuck must take place. If you fuck the queen, the kingdom is yours. Not even the pretense that the kingdom is mine, that it is my sponsorship that gives you your place. Not even the pretense. Oh no, Jocasta will speak. Almost entirely destroyed. Beautiful Thebes torn and wasted. No brother can speak for me. Where is the spirit in me that I am so destroyed? My son, my husband, what difference would it make to me? A man is a man. I am long gone. Could I reclaim my damaged soul? And the other side. And further be said of love. That has always more to go. Ever-expanding love, always, always, wherever, however, always the gift, the blessing, comes as it comes, always and never the same. Ever-expanding, every drop and opening, wondering mind, adoring the only possible response. Comes as it comes, drop, moment, rain, sight, gratitude, the only possible, respect, the only possible. Ink blots the untouched page. Complicated invention letters. Subtle variations of shape to hold distinct identity through many kinds of use. Magic invention, to think of it, a mark and then a few marks for inventory and the like. Or graphic illustrations scratched in the sand of some abstract construction, engineering, or theory. Arithmetic invents itself. A few marks and all of logic yields its harvest in time. By our stupidity, our unrealism, our denial, civilization. Eat the apple then. Incarnate. Connectedness. Irrelevance. Contrast. Sea of pain, no doubt. Pathways out, no doubt. Swim in the sea, wash in it, endlessly moving. And then a quotation from Lady Orpheus, I love not death, and yet, how can I help it? Its beauty and the wisdom it holds. Seattle, in the midst of the mess, still here, real working artists, doing into a reality, unisolate, doing into a reality, artistic outpouring into a reality, not a void, air of life, not dead air, still here, alive and busy, professional skills, self-responsibility, to do, not in a cave, to fling into the world, and the world willy-nilly must take it in. Beauty is not only for itself, interfaced with the world, working artists. Song unsung is not a song. Song sung cannot but be heard, and universal song the sweeter for it. Unquestioned and unspoken, working artists. It is the unevenness of breath and life, of soul travels, of any sentient learning, the very unevenness that makes the song. Beat as well as lyric, bass line, rhythm, the unevenness starts and stops, flowing or gagging, breath coming easy or hard, is the storyline. The story, the plot, the progression and sequencing, the journey like a rainstorm or a love affair. Full circle somehow, ups and downs, starts and stops, hesitations and uncertainties in their own particular order. This is the song of life everywhere. The other worlds are always really there. But on a quiet winter night, with only trees and stars and small woodland creatures, listening to the almost sounds, one could dream away into somewhere. Is there someone? Do I hear? Approach? A breath, listening, width of quiet, broad across the land, layer of life that rests on the land. A dozen feet high or so, a belt of atmosphere, the zone of living. Listening, the difference between this world and any other. Almost no difference at all. Creatures are alive, some sleeping, some awake. Here in the simple 3D planet, where ink and paper meet with mind and fingers along the moving pen. While others maybe have their own concretion around the soundless sound and breathless presence, that listening in quiet woodland winter night suggests. When I'm with you, I'm not going anywhere. I'm already somewhere. We do this for each other instead of for ourselves. Progressive attention to the delicate sensation. Persistent attention. As delicacy rises stronger and stronger, climbing and climbing, lost in pleasure, forgetting even the hand that strokes, until breaking face to face, all is revealed, seen naked, and completion comes for each other instead of for ourselves. Most intense selfness, most intensely shared moments of mutual completion. Without necessarily, as I say, even taking off my clothes. Body reaching, yearning, aching for the exact touch. Reaching, stretching, naked, greedy, most beautiful and most unbeautiful for each other instead of for ourselves. Most private, most exposed, most complex. When I'm with you, I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to take advantage of a tradition I'm fond of and read one piece from the new work, because this is an end to something, and I have been fortunate enough to have something else to do after I finished with what I spent my life on. A gypsying, again we go, Athena, an owl, and I. A gypsying, a singing, a gypsying. Mountains and lakes and deserts, bags full of gypsy scatters, scarves and jewels and brightly colored cards, paints and unguents. Together, owl and I, we carry the god around, the image, the deity, our accustomed form. Owl and I, we report to Athena, owl and I. Flying ahead and above me, she surveys the ground, occupies the mouse, the mice, and selects one by one, each one she chooses to eat, leaving the rest for later. A gypsying to inhabit the world, one bite at a time. Owl and I, we go, loving the spring and the worlds we discover, and indeed all the people who come to hear us speak.
Thank you so much, Margareta, that was beautiful. Next, we'll hear from Judith Roche, also a Seattle area poet, who's here in support of her newest book, All Fire, All Water. She's published four works of poetry, one of which, Wisdom of the Body, won an American Book Award and was nominated for a Pushcart Prize. She's an extremely well-respected poet and an old friend of Elliott Bay Book Company, and we're so pleased to welcome her back tonight. Please welcome Judith Roche to the stage.
My favorite people are here tonight. This is very wonderful. First of all, I want to thank David Berger for the beautiful cover art. David is here somewhere. He's there. And Jerry Gold, who published this book and the previous two. Is Jerry here? I haven't seen him. Okay, well, I'm grateful. So this book has four sections in it. The first, and I'm going to tell you what each four sections are like, and then I'll read a few from each section. The first section is called Rivers Have Memories, and it's the nature poems. I'm known largely as a nature poet, but I write a lot of other things too. So nature poems, such things, poems of place, and I teach poetry of place, so I'm very interested in place-based work. The second one is called A Bird Caught in the Throat, and it is the poems that of being horrified at things that go on in the world and being moved so that I have to write poems about it. So I'll read a few of those. The third section is called The Husband's Sweet, and I have spelled sweet S-W-E-E-T instead of S-U-I-T-E, and it's kind of deep memory poems. It's been a long time since I had husbands, but I did. Don't even think of them that often, but for a while, they kept coming back in dreams. And so I wrote this series of poems about them. And the last one section is called We Are Stardust, coming from the Joni Mitchell song, We Are Stardust, We Are Golden. That's the last section. So first poem here is an Easter poem. Well, it's vernal equinox. It's a spring poem. And today is not only the first day of Passover, it's Good Friday. It's an important day in a lot of religions' calendars. So, vernal equinox. A green wind rushes over cold ground, freshening what's left of winter slush. Trees gush song, blush crimson, gold stipples, extending branches. Persephone returns, her rejoicing mother starts seeds and tubers rumbling underground, teeming with life. Daffodil and hyacinths erupt, unfueling sweet scent of spring. A row of wild onions takes fire from the new moon. Pale green pea tendrils push out of earth, and the wounded god will walk the land, whole again, becoming radiant with resurrection. This one is the cranes, crane on book. I spent several weeks in Platte River, Nebraska, two springs ago. It is the largest crane migration in the world. It's just an incredible sight. Just the many hundreds of thousands of cranes in the air. And they're coming through on their way, and they stop. they on their way up north where they're going to go for the summer. Siberia, the Arctic is where they're going, and they stop in Platte River to get fat, to eat a lot because they're just too busy flying to eat while the rest of their trip. So they stop and fatten themselves and take off again. So, and it was the sound that I was particularly impressed by. So the cranes. The sound comes first, wild and wind-borne, a kind of purling purr, deep from long throats, larynxes that can bend and twist, but cranes fly with necks outstretched, legs and feet streaming long behind, chambers in the throat reverberating, sound to a thrum, strange song, a madrigal, together, voices in a fugue. Then the sight, long skeins, strings stretched over the river, not a flock, but threaded out, one after the other. Excuse me. Threaded out, one after the other, seemingly unending, pouring across the river in almost endless flow, a waterfall of river fowl to settle in the shallow waters, edging sandbars, the better to hear coyote, fox, bobcat splashing toward them. Long and lovely they come, red-headed and hungry, stop and fuel for the long flight ahead. In crepuscular light, silver and darkening, we are cold in the bird blind. A mean wind creeps around corners between cracks, knotting our fingers and toes, but we must stay until they settle. Finally, it's too dark to see. We make our way out, single file, away from the river, silence and hope. This one is called Fishtown Lower Skagit. some of you who have been artists around here for a long time know about Fishtown, which was where the Skagit goes into Puget Sound. And a long time ago, 70s, a lot of artists lived there. They were squatting. They didn't own the land. They built little cabins, little places to live. And it was quite a wonderful artistic community. Eventually, they got all cleaned out, and they're not there anymore. And in fact, Fishtown is not there at all. I was fortunate enough to visit a few people there. Robert Sund was there, and Tim McNulty, and a bunch of people, a bunch of names that you might know. So anyway, I went last June, I think, I went on a canoe, a big 18-person paddling canoe out to visit where it was. And this is the poem, and it was really, really raining that day. Cold and rainy June day. So, Fishtown, Lower Skagit, has an epigraph. Language burned in us. We were wild with ideas, Bob Rose. Water rocks under us. Water pours over us from a slate sky. Water collects at the bottom of the boat, drips off our hat brims, soaks through our clothes. Purple larkspur shows vivid against rain-blackened rock faces. Columbine in niches clinging in shallow soil. Saxifrage shines white on succulent stems. A red-tailed hawk drifts above, looking for lunch. We rock in the river's current. Paddles ready, then all paddles ahead, and paddles rest. Shouted from the back of the boat. A mean wind arrives from the south. We're pilgrims searching the ghosts of Fishtown, hovering in the Skagit rain. But most shacks have been torn down, the land logged, leaving bare bones or nothing but green. The hopeful artists and scholars of the estuary scattered, mostly still around the valley, still making art. All in our 60s and 70s now, some have passed a life lived for art, as ephemeral as a dance. But many leave a trail of poems, paintings, and paintings behind. None can quite leave behind the life lived on the Skagit, the youthful hope and dedication. Shacks, landmarks, and channels gone, but rivers have memories, says Bob Rose. They adjust as in their beds. Robert Sund is gone, but his tight little cabin is a refuge from today's rain. We huddle inside and crowd around the wood stove, drink hot tea and listen to Tim McNulty read Sund's poems of his place. Water, water, herons, rain, swallows, mud, and rain again. Even a former resident of Fishtown can't find what was there. The river has changed channels, and Fishtown is a state of mind. All right. I do a lot of seasonal poems. This is a Halloween poem. Called Autumn Twilight. The witch is in her kitchen, stirring up a soup. The crow is in his treetop, summoning up a storm. The storm is in the stratosphere, muscling up her sinew. The rain is on the rooftop, throbbing out a song. The river runs her riverbanks, swelling all along. And I am in my cedar house, staring at the lessening light, going, going, gone. The witch is feeding elves and trolls. The crow is flying higher. The storm may dissipate or not, depending on the weather. The elves and trolls begin to eat a rank and unidentified meat.
The river's flowing on, but the twilight is still creeping, going on.
You know, when you see that light going away, Okay, now a couple poems from the second section called The Bird Caught in the Throat. This first poem I wrote when at the beginning of the first Gulf War, and the next poem I think is probably at the beginning of the second Gulf War. And the news just was so horrible every day. Just have to say something. So this is called Arcane Expositions, and the epigraph is from Anne Carson. Like peacocks stepping out of cages and onto the empty kitchen of God. Another word for terror is a bird caught in the throat. Another word for now is black bits of paint flecking off. They fly away in a flock and settle down with slit tongues. Many women die in childbirth in hail of storm of stones. Many children catch those stones, debris falling like shooting stars. Another word for desert is the rain dreams fire and falls in a red lake. We have dreaded this like death. We knew it was coming. Oil flows first in the rivers and old truths come to life. Presaged by rivers on fire and acid hailstones, tessellated out into its logical conclusion. Another word for wilderness is honey in the comb. Another word for bees is black and gold song. Another word for greed is teeth bite off a piece of ass. It could be anybody's. Another word for form is cabbages roasting in ash, taking shape of human body. Another word for us is a cluster of chromosomes. Another word for gravity is the love of home. There are no synonyms. Another word for now is the walls come tumbling down. I won't read too many of these war poems. They're awful. But this is another war poem called The Face of War. And its epigraph comes from Homer, from, you know, the grand war poem of history, the Elliot. And it's the first line. Sing, divine muses, of the wrath of Achilles. With polyphonic voices we sing the horror of these mutilated cities where immortal cruelty roams our halls and pathways, punctuated by beauty, shafts of life slatting through our ribs. We follow bloody footsteps down corridors of fallen feathers, past and clusters of gathered flowers rotting in the stench of neglect. A small child wanders in the debris. Somewhere the mother is torn apart, and no one has found the imagination to bury her broken body. Somewhere the father is busy with his work of killing other children. Though he prays for his own, now lost in a ruined house, the river fattens with rotted bodies, the rain weaves a dense shroud heavy with the weight of grief. The young, excited by the sheer energy of moving parts, meshing and unmeshing, hear screams of metallic song in a streaming sunset, black and crimson. The old know we have been here before, making the same wrong turns. The dead turn their backs, haunting the road. The songs turn and turn again, slit the throat of night and spill over, returning like rhyme, extending vowels, howling the same note. That's enough of those. (Clears throat) Okay, this is a few poems from The Husband's Suite. And the first one, which is like an intro to the section, is called The Husband's Suite, but it's spelled S-U-I-T-E. Each an etude in which I lied to learn something technical, but played for artistry. A string and a strand, a block and a battery, the bitter bundled in the heavy honeyed swarm. Vacations of vacant vocations, the flung over the shoulder, fare thee well. Exercises in experience, more expensive than I can tell. And this one is just called The Husbands. It's the first one of this group that I wrote. I married them all for the wrong reasons. One for sex, another for a boat. Though the boat wasn't for me, but for the son left behind for the sex I married the first one for. But it was the daughter I carried inside when I married the first one. There were others, but they didn't count as husbands. The third I didn't even marry. He read me poems in bed and left little behind, nothing of any value. But the pain turned out about the same. And then there was my daughter, steady there through all of it, watching me with blue owl eyes, thinking, is this the way you do it? We had boat enough to teach us of the sea, the beauty of fish, the sun's love for water. The first left me my daughter and my son both, my dawn, noon, sunset, and night. The husbands are all far away now, two into that great good night, strange to have outlived them. The third off in his own mysteries. They surface in my dreams. Sometimes even the others join in, as lions, as kings, as husbands. They all blend together, vivid, purring loudly and shape-shifting. I love them, or him, the one great husband for whom I am still a wife. And another, this one I think of as a deep memory poem. Stories from a lot of my life. And it has an epigraph from Jack Spicer. It is, "The Ghost Canyon of Memories." There was a boat on the, it's called Postcards from Water. There was a boat on the shore, and we sat out in it. Pull, 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 through drag the weight of water. We don't know where we go, love in a lifeboat. We could go beyond maps and off the shelf of the known earth. Dear Mick, in this card you have turned your back on me. Typical when I wanted you to pay attention, but you paid too much attention when I didn't want it. Dear Mick, I'm sorry for your sorrow and relieved to be free. Dear Mick, our children are doing fine, but bereaved of a father, bereaved of boats. The river is iced, cars can drive across. What does that have to do with me? Summer on the water, sun and sparkle, summer at the cottage with no shoes, winter and wind sculpted great hills of piled up frozen water. We walked out a long way, much further than we could swim in summer. This is Lake Erie, which leads to the Detroit River. Cars can drive on it, a dead seagull iced in, white on white. What does that have to do with me? Dear Mother, in this card, you've taken me to the art museum again.
Once I told a man my main relationship with my mother was through art and literature, and he found it tragic. Not so, dear mother. You gave me a world beyond the hard-worked streets of our mid-century industrial city and stifled ideas. Dear mother, the children grew up strong and fine, but bereaved of a grandmother. I tried to tell the stories, but didn't do it as well as you. Dear river, cars drive on your surface. A tunnel flows under the water, another country the other side. When we rode through the tunnel as children, we ducked our heads and laughed. We drove across the bridge, my young husband and I, on the way to the cottage and summer on Lake Erie, babies in the back seat. Dear ice, the rum runners crossed on your surface. Some booze-loaded cars broke through and drowned. Some rusted hulks still at the bottom. What does this have to do with me? Dear river, it's said the lakes never give up their dead. Do you, dear river, know the names of your dead? Dear road, I've traveled you from the city of the Straits, Detroit, and far beyond. My father taught me how. I wrapped the river around me like a scarf, immersed myself in the Great Lakes. Sweeter than the sea, I come from you. My young husband taught me how, before the sorrow that overtook us. Dear road, what do you have to do with me? Dear roadside flowers, Queen Anne's lace, pearly everlasting. Dear Diana of the hunt, where have your lean hunting hounds gone? The blue tit and the black and tan, they bugle in the distance, a clean, clear song. Dear father, dear uncles, you gave me the hounds. Dear hounds, you gave me the night. Dear river, I come home to you. There is a boat on the shore. We set out in it. The drag, the weight of water, sweet water. Dear Salish sea, saline, not sweet, astringent. Phosphorescence shines on you. I set out.
Okay, we've come to the last section, and just a few poems. In this section that is called We Are Stardust, and I'll read that poem last, poetry, this is a cliche, every poet knows. Poetry is trying to explain what we don't understand, is trying to say the unsayable. But these poems are an attempt to understand what you don't understand, which all poems are in some way. So the first one is called No Map, appropriately enough. How do we know where we are when the stars we navigate by no longer exist? Our mothers are dead, taking with them what they knew. Our fathers are dead, not that they had a clue. We collect what hard-saved coordinates we've gathered, like wool from ghost sheep whispering through our fingers, like the gods' feathers molting in the wind. In it, no place at all, ancestors have moved. The boundary stones, ley lines may persist, possibly following underground rivers, and songs may activate them. Somehow, paths do seem to cross, and there we find what we can at the crossroads. And another, in much the same vein, a lot of the poems also are not trying to understand, but also kind of struggling with communication between peoples. And I know this comes from having a son I can't speak to. And he can't speak to me, but we do sign language.
Translation, and the epigraph is from Willa Cather. The heart of another is a dark forest. One, the crows gather for Congress. They rattle and caw in the crow tree, noisy and insistent. And I caw back, ululating at the boundaries of species, trying to tell them my secret name, trying to learn it from them. Dear Dr. Doolittle talked to the animals. St. Francis preached to the birds. Rabbits and fish followed him to hear his words, and he bargained with the wolf. Some say barn animals, cattle, sheep, will speak in human voices at midnight on Christmas Eve. But I look to crow speak, or cat, or horse, or crane, or salmon. How must we climb these sounds to something not known? I am scrambling hand over hand, rocks falling around me, out of the limitations of the word without a map, chart, or Rosetta Stone, to step from stage to stage. Two, light moves through my body, but stops at what? I walk a frozen river to where it becomes water, fluid and moving, and toward gill slits, the lungs I inherited and the name I was given, the voice I found myself with, the bridge of crossing over one language to another, the syntax of one consciousness for another, in the mute and moving hands, echo and sound absorption or vibrating larynx. Tell me, is it possible to love without translation? This is the last poem I'm going to read. And this is the one that comes from Joni Mitchell, We Are Stardust, which I always thought was metaphor. This is a pantoum, and so there's a lot of repeated words, you'll hear that. Metaphors of dust. As it turns out, we actually are stardust. I thought it was metaphor of life and space and time. Apparently, our materials are 13 million years old. We are star stuff pondering the story told in the life of the stars. Our ancestors include imploded stars. They are with us now, our dust, but we continue the story as additions, epilogues, a metaphor for all that's been in this old galaxy, the gravity of time. Big balls of burning light and time, say the website of the stars. How many millions of years old? And we are made of that dust. I can hardly tell now what is not metaphor and literally the story behind the story. We are stardust pondering our own story. We are spirit and story and caught in time of existence as metaphor. For what? That we are stars and like stars will become dust when we are old? But it's so old, this grand often told story, that we are dust and turn to dust. We are an instance of star in story, of rocks, glaciers, carbon-based creatures, stars. We become the metaphor. And in this metaphor, we are all old souls, stuff of ancient stars, singing our story and whatever it says about our mixture of star and dust. We are the metaphor for the story. Old souls swirling in the wind tunnel of time, spirit, and star, and dust. We do have time.
time for a Q&A for both Margaret. You want to come up, Margaret?
Sure.
You can both do this. Cues.
I'm so naked already.
Well, we don't have to do one, but he wants to. Questions, comments?
It's really good to just stand here and look at you all and say my words and not lose the qualities and all that. It's just beautiful. This is a beautiful moment. Everyone in it makes it what it is.
Priscilla?
How long did it take you both to do to create the books?
Oh, I'm very slow. My last book was 2007. And these are the best poems since 2007. They're not all the poems, but you know, the ones that end up in the book.
Well, yeah, I'm slower. My last big book was generally speaking, I put little chapbooks and then put out a big one. And the last one was 2005, and the poems here are pretty much the bulk of what happens in the last 10 years. I don't, when I put together a book, I don't judge particularly by the best. I acknowledge that in this book, wherever you may have one, you'll find only the best. What you'll find is, as best I can, a full view of the landscape. And some of them are good and some of them aren't. And I'll say right here that the poem which I did not write, which is the introduction to the book, is, in my opinion, a better poem than at least a third of what's in the book. But still, the message is there, and I'm not ashamed of it at all. But it's 10 years, and 3 years to put the book together, because unlike Judith, I didn't have Jerry's help. I did that myself.
Sharon?
Speaking as a member of your poetry community, and then, of course, all of us are in a big poetry community together, both of you addressed something about the isolation of writing, but the community dimension of rewriting, maybe?
Rewriting, I don't know. Do you have an opinion on that? I just have an opinion about everything.
Yeah, you do. Sharon and I are in the same poetry group. So, you know, I guess that's what I would say, is it is our poetry group that helps me with the rewriting, and I do a lot of reworking, a lot. And they're never done. They're abandoned, as people say. But I think having people to work with is very useful. Also, I teach a rewriting class, and so yeah, that I don't know if that helps or not. Phoebe?
You say they're never done, but are you ever going to work on these same poems again? The one thing, like Odman, some of these people, you know, you publish a poem, somebody writes, and then 20 years later or 10 years later, you say, I'm going to publish that poem, and the poem has been written by them completely different than the one you originally published. I mean,
Not very much.
although
I have added to poems when I've published them, they're supposedly done when they're published, and I think they kind of stay that way. But I have, when people have wanted old poems that fit into an anthology, I've reworked them. Yeah. Yeah. What I do, David? I did give David the manuscript. I also told him, that I was really interested in cranes and a crane for the cover, and he read the manuscript and came up with this. It had a different title. It wasn't All Fire, All Water, but first place, I like this title better than the working title, but also I think it goes really well with David's painting.
I could say something to this too, because I've put together a lot of books and it's different every time, but it seems to me you picked up a really significant question. In this book, it's different from any other one for me, in that the illustrators saturated themselves with the poems and then did a whole bunch of work, but didn't assign a particular piece to a particular poem. And always before, when I put a book together, usually in cooperation with whoever the author is, we try to fit them to each other. But this was a separate process, and then it came together, and there's another kind of magic that happens there. But I think basically, you have to let the book be the body for the work, just like a baby.
David, you want to add anything to? No.
Okay.